My name is Sarah Fornace, and I'm one of the co-artistic directors of Manual Cinema. I'm here in our studio in Chicago to teach you a workshop today. I would like to show you how to make manual cinema style puppet shows at home. What is a manual cinema style show, you ask? Good question. I made this video to show you a little bit about what we do. Uses simple materials like paper, light, and our bodies in shadow silhouette to make shows that look like movies. We often tell stories without using words, and music and sound are a really important part of how we tell the stories in our shows. I would like to show you the beginning of one of our shows, Ada Ava, and then I'll show you with the puppets how we made it. So everything you just saw in Ada Ava was made with these overhead projectors. They used to be used in schools back in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, and now we have taken them to make shows. We take pieces of paper on the overhead projector, and that lets us open and close the shots, which allows the images to appear on screen and allows us to do all sorts of things, like make the lightning flash on the lighthouse, and also transition from one shot to the next. All of our puppets are made of very simple materials. All of the shadows are made of paper, which we cut out with X-Acto knives and scissors. And then the backgrounds, where you see color and more detail, like the clouds behind this lighthouse, we design them on the computer and we print them out on acetate, which is like a plastic film. Then we tape these two pieces together to make the scene. And we often tape them into these frames so that when we put them on the overhead projector, we know that they're in the right place. Manual cinema often tells stories without words. Our shows look like silent movies. So in order to tell our story, we need a visual language. And we use the visual language of film. All of our shows are composed of close-up, medium, and far shots. And you saw each of these types of shots in A to Ava. At the beginning, we're on a far shot of the lighthouse. And then once we go inside their house, we see a series of close-ups, like the close-up on this clock. Far shots are great for setting the scene, for showing us the environment. Close-ups are great for showing us details and what we want to pay attention to. The last type of shot, which is one of my favorites as a shadow actor, is the medium shot. Medium shots are great for showing a character interacting with the environment around her or interacting with other characters. So a medium shot usually shows the character's body from the knees up to right above the head. To make my shadow on the screen, I've got the light on one side of me, and then I put my body in between myself and the screen. So light, person, screen. I love medium shots because characters can interact with each other. Like I can meet Shadow the dog. Shadow is just actually a very small puppet on top of the overhead projectors that we just saw. So I have to practice using my own shadow to make it look like we're in the same space. I also make sure that whenever I'm acting in shadow, I show my nose because people can't see my eyes, and that shows what I'm looking at. In addition to interacting with puppets and medium shots, you can interact with the environment around you. So we make puppets like this one here, where you can see I'm in a cartoon of a city. This is a panning shot, which shows me walking through the city. We're running back. And we have to use teamwork for the puppeteer to move the background as I move my shadow. One last trick I want to show you is falling down the hole. This is one of my favorites. How we come up with these is we think about, hey, what would be a fun thing to do in shadow? And then we make a puppet to go with it. Ready? Each of the puppets in our shows is designed to only do one thing. For instance, this Ada is designed to walk underneath her umbrella. She can look down and she can look up. And that's it. So if we need her to run through a mirror maze or climb a staircase or any number of other things, or even walk without an umbrella, we just build a separate puppet. This allows us for our puppets to be very simple and easier to make and easier to work with. Every single one of our shows has about 500 puppets in it. So we need each puppet to work well every single time it's up on the projector. Scale, or how big or small you make your puppets, is very important. This puppet is small. She's made for a medium far shot. The smaller you make your puppets, the farther away they seem and the more of the environment you can see around them in the scene. However, if I wanted to make a close-up shot, I would make a bigger puppet. This is Lula Del Rey from another one of our shows. And you can see this close-up, her head is bigger than Ada's whole body. She's sized to the frame so that we get to see a close-up on her face. This type of shot doesn't allow us to see the environment in the same way, but it's great for other storytelling, such as reaction shots that tell us how Lula's feeling. Or we can look with the character and see her see something, which helps us understand the next part of the story. One element of our visual storytelling is the type of shot, a close-up, medium, or far shot. And the other big piece is transitions. How do we get between shots? Or, simply, what images do we put next to each other? For instance, I have here my close-up head of Lula, and she could walk onto the shot, and then we see her gasp, and she looks up, and then if I cut to this far shot of a lighthouse, by juxtaposing these images together and cutting quickly between them, we convey the story point that, oh my goodness, she saw the lighthouse at the top of the cliff. Then we could cut back to Lula. We see her make a decision through movement of her head, and then she walks off. And again, because we put that image of the lighthouse before her moment of walking off, we're conveying the story, oh, she saw the lighthouse and she's going towards it. Because each puppet only does one thing, we only need to build enough puppet for that shot. For example, we have the whole body of Ada here because we see her from head to toe. But that close-up head of Lula, she actually doesn't have a body at all because we don't see it in the shot. This allows the puppets to be simpler and helps us build more of them in the short amount of time that we have to make a show. So today I want to teach you how to make a cinematic puppet show at home. I know everyone doesn't have overhead projectors hiding in their closets, and so I want to teach you how to make a cinematic puppet show with illustrated puppets. We use this technique in a lot of our shows, including in our upcoming show, The Christmas Carol. Here's a sneak peek. So these puppets are all made out of paper, and unlike the shadow puppets on the overheads, because we move these puppets in front of the camera, we can fill them with detail because the audience will be able to see it. The puppets are made out of different colors of paper, and then we use ink and marker to draw details on them. They're constructed pretty simply. We just tape them together with blue tape. Usually we put a stick on them so we can move them around. Like our shadow puppets, each puppet is made to only do one thing, and so we only make as much puppet as we need. This puppet of Scrooge doesn't have any legs, he can't walk down the street, because he was made for a reaction shot. So in the shot that this puppet is in, he just puts his hand to his mouth and gasps. So we only made as much puppet as we need. We can use different colors of paper to make puppets at different scales. So if our last puppet was designed for a medium shot, this puppet is designed for a far shot where we can see Scrooge in his environment. In this shot, he opens his window on Christmas Day to look out at the street below. One of the things I like about this style of puppetry is that we can make all sorts of shots and go all sorts of places. So we can be in Victorian London and throw the shutters open because we're making everything just out of different pieces of colorful paper. We use different tricks in our on-camera puppetry than we use in our shadow puppetry. For instance, this is a gentleman from The Christmas Carol, and he's designed to react in surprise. So we can draw one facial expression on one side and then flip the puppet around and reveal his other facial expression for his reaction to when he hears the news that Scrooge is going to donate a lot of money to his charity cause. Often when we do on-camera puppetry, we'll also use objects that we find around our studio or around our home. So for instance, this is the Ghost of Christmas Past, and she's one of my favorite characters in the show. And she has an old slide that she's showing to Scrooge, and it contains the memories of his past. In addition to these colorful puppets, we use our own faces and bodies, costumes, and sometimes junk we find around the house to tell fantastical stories, like a little girl creating a magic city out of junk in her attic, or Dr. Frankenstein creating the creature in his clock tower in Manuel Cinema's Frankenstein. The setup for the style of puppetry is actually very similar to a video chat program on a computer. I know a lot of you might be using Zoom or Google Hangouts to see family and friends or to go to school. And that style of camera and screen is actually perfect for making movies with illustrated puppets. And so today, I thought I would teach you how to use Zoom or Google Hangouts to make a puppet show. One of my favorite things about puppet shows is that you can tell any kind of story. You can go to any place that you can dream up. So you could tell a story that takes place in outer space. You could go to the big city or the desert. The first thing you need to do when making a puppet show is think, what do I want to tell a story about, and where should it take place? When I was trying to think up a story for today, I thought about the beach. I was sad this summer that I couldn't go to the beach with my family like usual, so I thought it would be nice to tell a story about the ocean that I can do safely here in the studio. So I'm going to entitle this show, An Ocean Adventure. An Ocean Adventure. And the first thing I need to do is to make a list of what type of puppets I need to make or what type of things I might need to find to tell the story. So if it's an ocean adventure, I need the ocean. So that style of puppet is something I would put under the heading setting. The setting is where your show takes place. So under setting, I am going to put the ocean. And I need to think about what kind of ocean it is. I think it's the high seas, a rough, adventurous ocean. And so I'm also going to make a wave. And then I think to myself, okay, what things are in the ocean? What might I find on the high seas? Aha, pirate ship. So under things, I'm going to put pirate ship. What other things might I want to put in my show? Ooh, a treasure chest. I would love to put a treasure chest in the show. And because it's my puppet show, the treasure chest could have anything in it, anything I like. It could have pizza, it could have magic. I think I'm going to go traditional here and go with gold doubloons. So I need a treasure chest and I need gold coins. So I have my place and I have my things. The next thing about the show is characters. Who do I want to be in this show? Well, I think I'm going to be a character in the show. And I'm going to be a swimmer under the sea. So I'll need some things to show the audience that I'm swimming. If I was at home, I could maybe grab my bathing suit and grab a towel, grab a snorkel and goggles. I don't have those things in the studio, so I'm just going to make them. I think I'll make a snorkel and goggles to create my swimming look around my face. So I need a puppet of a snorkel and goggles for me. And then who else might I meet under the sea? Ah, fish. And again, you can make the fish however you want. I think I'm going to make a rainbow fish. Really colorful, exciting tropical fish. Who else might I meet? So I'm in the ocean and there's a pirate ship. Aha, I think another great character for the show would be a pirate. So here I've got my list of puppets I need to make. I need to make my ocean setting. I need to make a few things that I encounter in the story. I've got my snorkel and goggles that are the costume for my character, and I've got fish and a pirate. Ooh, I think I want to add one more character since we're on an ocean adventure. I want to add a squid and some tentacles because I think those will be fun to make. So the next thing to do is to make the puppets. You can make the puppets in many different styles. In The Christmas Carol, we use this illustrated puppet style where we drew by hand with pencils and ink directly onto the paper and then we cut it out. If you like to draw, you can definitely hand draw your own puppets and then cut them. But there are many other styles you can do too. You can gather a bunch of magazines and do a collage style by cutting pictures out of the magazine. You can also use the computer. So what I did for my show today is that I used Google search and I searched each image. So I typed in pirate ship and it gave me a bunch of different pictures of pirate ships. And I could pick the exact one that I wanted to put in my show. I then printed it out on printer paper and cut it out. And I have my pirate ship right here. I cut out some of the details so that you can see them more easily on camera. I used this X-Acto blade. However, you can also use scissors. And then I taped a stick on the back of my pirate ship so that I'd be able to manipulate it on camera. There are a lot of different ways of moving puppets around. Marionettes use strings, and Muppets, their hands are up inside the fabric puppet. Often in manual cinema, we put our puppets on sticks. I also made the squid. This is one of my characters. I made the pirate. as you can see, this pirate and the squid are both the same size. So once we put them on camera, we can see how scale works in our puppet show. I also have my setting. I cut out a picture of the ocean because I really like this blue color. And then I found a different picture of a wave to animate my ocean. And then this is my costume puppet. This is my goggles and snorkel. This one, the size really did matter because it needs to be able to fit over my face on camera. So once you've drawn your puppets or cut them out of magazines or image search them and cut out images that you printed out, the next thing to do is to cut them out and assemble them. For us, I'm using blue tape to stick my sticks onto the puppets. And I make the stick long enough so that my hand isn't near the puppet. These sticks we found in the grocery store. I think that they're used for barbecue. They come in these kind of packs. But if you don't want to use sticks, you can also use straws. This is something else you might be able to find in your kitchen. And you can tape your puppets to this and use this to manipulate your puppets on the camera. Now that we have all of our puppets assembled, the next thing to do is to gather them to open our program, either Zoom or Google Hangout, and move them around in front of the computer. Let's go do it. So now that we've made our puppets, it's time to stage our puppet show. The first thing I did was open up my computer and open up the Zoom program. Then I set up my computer on top of these boxes on top of the table. That's because I want the computer camera to be high enough that I can move all around and run around and act inside of it. If you put it on your table, it might be too low. The first thing you want to do is to check out your puppets on the camera and see what they look like. For instance, this is my ocean puppet. So when I hold it out here with me, I'm about 5 or 6 feet from my camera, it just looks like a picture printed on a piece of paper. So what I want to do as a puppeteer is I want to look at the screen below where I've got my image that the Zoom program is showing to me, and I want to use that to look at my puppet and see where it wants to be. So still too far away, still too far away. Here, it fills the whole frame, and I can animate it so it looks like an ocean. In addition to making your puppets fit on screen, thinking about how far from the camera is important for storytelling as well. Remember in shadow when we talked about close-up, medium, and far shots? You want to do the same thing for Zoom puppetry. So if I'm close to the lens, I'm in a close-up, and this is good for seeing detail or a reaction shot. If I come all the way back here, you can see a lot of the space around me. This is good for seeing bigger actions or the character inside the environment. And then anywhere in between is a medium shot. And medium shots are great for characters meeting each other. For example, I have my fish here, who I can interact with in this medium shot. In addition to close-up, medium, and far shots, another important thing to think about when making your Zoom puppet show is transitions, or the storytelling that happens by moving from one image to the next. In movies, when they're creating the final cut, they're cutting together different shots. So they stop and start the camera, and then they stitch that all together in an editing program. But when we're making a Zoom puppet show, the camera is rolling the whole time. And like a piece of theater, we need to go from beginning to middle to end, all in one take. So what I want to do is I can use the puppets to help me transition from one place to another, or one point in the story to another. For instance, I can take my sea puppet and say that we're on top of the sea, right, where we might be seeing our ship. But then I want to transition to seeing a fish underneath the sea. So I could use the puppet to block the camera, we can fly underneath the sea, and then I can bring in my fish. And that transition helps us understand that we're going from one place, above the water, to another place, underneath the sea. Now that we've looked at our puppets on the computer, we've thought a little bit about close-up, medium, and far shots, and we've come up with some transitions, it's time to stage the show. This is Drew Dirt. He is another one of the artistic directors of Manual Cinema. He's also my husband, which is why we have our masks off around each other. And he's going to help me make my puppet show. You can make your puppet show at home with just one person. You can make it with two or three people or five. However many people you have in your household who might want to make the puppet show with you are welcome. The more the merrier. So Drew's going to take some of the puppets, and I'm going to take some of the puppets. And I've arranged them around us. We have tables and music stands. Any surface you have in your house works as a puppet holder. We've talked a little bit about who wants to do which puppet when. And now we're going to stage our show. So you don't need an overhead projector to make a shadow show at home. All you need is a light. You can use a lamp with a light bulb. I highly recommend using an LED light, such as you might find inside a flashlight or a desk lamp, because they make very crisp shadows. You can throw your shadows on a white wall or behind a screen, like the one I'm on. The fabric of this screen is actually very similar to the fabric that is in shower curtains. A shower curtain is a great shadow screen to use, or you can simply use a white bed sheet. I can take the puppets that I made for my Zoom show and try them out in shadow. So this is my ship from the Zoom show. It actually works really well as a shadow puppet. So you can't see the color and detail that were nice on camera in the Zoom show, but you can see the shape of the ship in shadow. And the shape of the ship works really well because it has a lot of positive and negative space. The positive space is the shadow that is made by the paper, and the negative space is all of the openings inside of it that gives the shadow its shape. And same as in the Zoom puppet show, how I animate it tells you the story of whether it's on the high seas or in the dock. And I'm still using my stick just like I was doing on my other show. When acting in shadow, we need to move a little bit differently than we do in the Zoom puppetry. In the Zoom puppetry, I wanted my face to be facing the camera. But here, you can't see what I'm looking at if I'm facing the screen or the light. Instead, I need to turn to the side and show the audience my nose. This helps the audience know what I'm looking at, and you can see a little bit of my facial expression. Another thing you can play with is size or scale. When I'm close to the screen, my shadow is as small as it can be. And then the closer I get to the light, the bigger my shadow gets. This is good for an extreme close-up shot, but it's also good for playing with size. So for instance, I could be a giant compared to this fish. just like I did with Shadow the dog and the overhead projectors, I want to use my shadow to interact with this shadow. So I'm not grabbing for the puppet because then my hand would get huge and I would give away the trick. Instead, I'm going to keep my hand close to the screen and think about using the edge of my shadow to hold this tentacle. And now we can have the fight with each other. Yeah, ow. Yeah, ow. Thank you so much for watching this workshop video. I hope that you'll make your own puppet shows. These styles of puppetry are great because you can tell really epic stories using really simple and inexpensive materials. If you have a piece of paper and a pen and you can dream it up, you can tell a story about it. I'm really excited for the types of stories that you are going to come up with and tell with both on-camera and shadow puppets. If you want to check out some of Manual Cinema's stories, we have a lot of free videos online, and you can find them at www.manualcinema.com.